We've been doing a series of talks, workshops, performances, parties, obviously. And this one's going to be a special one. We've got a production masterclass, they're calling it, with Teebs. If you don't know Teebs, he is a LA-based producer, has released on people like Hit and Run, All City, but his home, I guess, would be the Brainfeeder label, which he's released multiple releases since 2010. We're going to go through some of his productions, his sounds. We're going to do this chronologically. About 30 seconds before the cameras turned on, I was like, I want to hear the stuff before you were a released artist and get that early, early vibe to really see the progression of your sound, your way of thinking with music. So I'm getting you to dig deep, dig early.
Yeah, dig a grave, basically.
Dig the grave. Well, I mean, me personally, as someone who doesn't produce but wants to produce, it's always good to hear, almost reassuring for maybe producers at home or in the room today, like how people start, and maybe give them a bit of like positivity of like, you know, sticking with the craft to get to where you are now, which is like an established producer, very well loved by myself, loads of people in the room, people watching online. I don't want to big you up too much. Let's just go straight into the beat. So you told me you kind of started pre-sample based. You just used to like mess around, right?
Right. So like I still use the same program I've been using since I started around, where I've had this program since 90 something. My older brother, he was the one that introduced me to Fruity Loops, and you know, they were rapping and stuff, and I thought it'd be cool to be a part of it. And I'm not really much of a rapper, so I figured I could make beats or something, and that fell short really fast around 2000, when I started using it, 2003 or something. And then I was just messing around. I never really thought of it as a serious thing. He wasn't using my beats, so that was, I mean, you'll hear why.
Oh, you initially started making beats for your
brother? I was just trying to impress the, yeah. Oh, he was just like, yeah, it's interesting. But, you know, I tried doing some like very straightforward kind of like boom bap stuff, which never worked out. I kind of quit on that. And then,
was anyone helping you, like your brother, or
no?
Did you have any like mentor? It's all self-taught.
No, it was by myself, because he was very distant. And then also most of my friends at that time were all skateboarders, and sitting at home wasn't the idea, basically. Most of the guys want to just go out and skate. And so it's like, what are you doing? Why are you staying in your house?
Yeah, like, we're going to go skate. We'll see you later. And
I kind of got like, you know, ostracized a little bit. Just getting pushed away. Just like, you're not going out and skating. I mean, they're still my buddies today, but definitely, yeah, everything was kind of changing right there.
It's kind of part and parcel of being a producer that you're a little bit of a hermit that stays at home.
Yeah.
It's kind of... So should we, as far back as you'll let me, because you didn't want to go too far back.
No.
Hear some of the early...
So this is a tune. It's all stock, Fruity Loops. I think they were calling FL3 at the time. Like, very disturbing sounds. And it's so melodic, it's disturbing. So this is one of the first things I was...
So what year are we talking about for this?
I mean, it's tagged 2005.
Ooh, 2005.
Yeah, I didn't really know much about music then, so it was just kind of, I had a program and I was playing with it. So now you get an idea of some of the first things that just came out of my head. I didn't really have musical training or nothing like that, so.
12 years old, should we?
Sure. Thank you.
sounds dope to me, man. He says it gradually gets worse. That sounds better than a lot of producers I know who are out there now. So this was pre-sampling, right?
Yeah, that was like...
All on Fruity Loops.
All on Fruity Loops with the keyboard.
Like, is there a particular reason why you is it just because your brother gave it to you and then you just... Did you try other softwares, other programs out when you were making beats?
At that point, no, that was just there and... you know, something to do. But I mean, as we go along, I started to reach out to other programs because of, situations I was in. I was actually at a program through Red Bull Music Academy and they had me doing, I was one of the students there in 2008 and I used Fruity Loops, which was a PC program. And
everyone was on Mac.
Yeah, the whole setup was all Mac, all Logic, or Ableton. So I had to start learning new stuff at that point, and that's when I just started experimenting more before the first record.
But you've kind of, to this day, stuck with Fruity Loops.
Yeah, I kind of gravitated back to it, because it's just, I think the tool really makes the product as well as, you know, you putting your energy into it. So yeah.
A lot of people say, a lot of serious producers use Fruity Loops, like Knife and Hudson Hall.
It's pretty funny.
Yeah. So you spoke to me earlier about how you then started using samples, and that's been prominent in all your production since.
Yeah, like all the proper releases are definitely very heavily sample based with me playing, you know, around it basically. Sometimes I pull the sample out, but I always kind of start there.
Can we hear the first track you did with a sample?
Yeah. So I'll play this one, Stan. Another one from that time as well.
You want to pull another one?
Yeah, let's go. So these two were kind of fun. On this one, I was just starting to like dump samples in, and the kind of funny part was an accident when samples fell into my computer.
You started sampling by accident?
Yeah, basically.
How?
I was just like surfing through files, and I think something happened where a song was dragged into Fruity Loops, and it was just there, and there was this thing called I'll show you later, but the Fruity Slicer, and it basically just accidentally chopped every single second of like a 3-minute song. So there was just stems for days, and I just started saying, oh shit, you know.
Oh wow, I can use
samples. Yeah, it's weird. Here's another one. Yeah.
So with these two tracks that you played that have used samples, I don't know what it looks like on Fruity Loops, but it seems there's a lot more textures and layers.
Yeah, so at this time I was getting really into all this weird like folly sound, which is all those like coins and strange stuff, because I like the idea of experimental, and I thought, well, what could I do from where I'm at? And actually, this is around the time I got this machine.
Yeah.
So
what's this?
This is a SP-404. It's just a simple, like a dumbed down version of an MPC.
Yeah.
Sample comes in, you affect it, and you can produce on it if you like. Or what I was doing mainly was dumping sounds directly back into Fruity Loops after picking them up. Has a built-in mic, and yeah, just worked with it directly.
So is it mainly just laptop Fruity Loops and this SP-404?
Yeah. Yeah.
Cool. And that's even to this day now?
Yeah.
Right. So we should probably move into actually, you know, when you actually started releasing music, which is around 2010.
Yeah.
And it's probably the work that people know you from because it's public and not something I force you to play on iTunes. Should we go through some of the beats around that time?
Yeah, definitely.
One more, which is from his debut album, Mardo. It's a long intro, just a pre-warning. So this is a track that we're actually going to break down for the audience, right? So one thing I wanted to do is actually, just because it fascinates me as a sort of buyer of records and just seeing how people work, is actually play the original sample that it comes from. So I'm going to do that quickly.
Yeah.
I've just been told the sample's at the very end, so let me just quickly scrub through on this. Should really have figured it out before this, before the cameras went live.
Yeah, that's it.
Right, so let's get into Fruity Loop Studio. Oh, there we go. So do you want to, firstly, your choice of samples, how do you dig them out? How do you find them? What are you looking for when you hear that and be like, right, I want to make a beat out of that?
It's just the clarity, the openness of it as well. I think a lot of the music I make as Teebs is very, like what you've been hearing in super melodic stuff, I like.
Very dreamy.
Yeah, it has a certain kind of thing that I used to gravitate towards so much. And for me, it was very just, like you said, dreamy. It was very easy for me to kind of meditate with that kind of sound on loop and, you know.
Do you make your music at a certain time? Like it always feels to me like it's made like really late night.
It always changes, but mainly now it's AM. Early in the morning, that's when I make music. Yeah. So, let me actually get into this. So that's that sample. Let me see if I can find. This is what Fruity Loops looks like. If you haven't seen it before, it's one of the older programs you could have got for free. You can still get the free demo and, you know, do what you got to do with it.
But now it's available on a Mac when previously.
Yeah, this is the new beta. I'm so excited about this. Let you guys know. I can do this now on a Mac, and it's pretty nice. But I kind of want to start with just that sample to begin with and just to kind of go through.
That's the original sample, no effects.
I think
no
it's slightly pitched up, but yeah, no
slightly
effects.
Slightly pitched up.
Yeah. And through this program, you can.
Are you classically trained in terms of like hearing?
Oh, no,
notes?
No.
None of that.
Zero training. I kind of wanted to even talk about this whole process and idea that it's really like a from nothing to something, and it won't be much of a tech-driven procedure of what I'm going to go through. It's more about just, you know, kind of reaching for what you want. Yeah, you're just kind of reaching for what you want of it. At least that's what I do. And so again, that's that sample. And normally what I do with sounds like these, I just kind of break them into, like if I had a MIDI keyboard, you can pull the whole sound or you can chop it yourself whenever, but if you run it through a MIDI, through Fruity Loops, it has this piano mode effect, and basically you're playing keys, but with the sample. So say if I had that sound to...
So it chops the notes up.
Yeah, so I'll show you through the piano roll to make it easier. I'll write it in. But say like the original sample, I just added like the same one octave down. So you kind of have like, yeah, that's a little gnarly. You gotta have all the range that the sample is going in, and when you layer it like that, you're getting this, basically the bass of it. Yeah, it's kind of wild. And so the idea of what I've been doing with a lot of these melodies is just kind of trying to build like that without overwhelming the sound.
Yeah.
So let's see. I'll just go kind of go into the pieces of the actual song. So here's one. And this is actually a reversal of the sample in two different pitches. So I'm just kind of like playing.
That's playing at the same time. So you reverse it, pitch it up, pitch it down, and have it playing at the same time.
Yeah. So now you got that happening. And then I have another melody.
I guess it makes more sense now when I said the stuff that you had with samples feels like it has a lot more textures and layers in it.
Yeah. That's kind of my main function on building sounds. And with this sound right now, what I've done to it is a slight compressor. I've filtered out some of the sounds. So it's just basically, once I keep adding more layers, it's just using your ear to not let the sounds get too muddied in certain like regions of the soundscape. Like,
do you always start with a sample when making a beat and then use that as the backbone?
Yeah, at this time I always start with the melody. I didn't really make beats drum first. That's usually the way to go, I think. And I actually nowadays I do prefer doing the drums first, but I feel like with the melody you kind of can react to the sounds and make drums that kind of react. And I think my music, it's so kind of off kilter and a little strange most of the time, almost hilarious at some points, as it's the drums are so, I don't know, like kiddish or something, but it kind of all fits into this whole world that I've been working in. So I'll just keep adding more of these melodies. I don't know if you can see the screen very well, but I'll keep adding more of the layers. And I'll just bring the volumes up one at a time, and you can see the additional, yeah.
That new sound that just came in, that's from the same sample. Just pitched up or...
Yeah.
So nothing in here is actually played, it's just manipulation of the original sample.
Bring the drums in now, so that's kind of it right there.
I'm assuming you don't quantize your drums.
But, yeah. Yeah.
Would you tap in the drums on the 404, or would you draw them in?
Drums, I usually tap in with a MIDI. I'll just kind of play them.
MIDI keyboard, or?
Yeah.
Do you have drum libraries that you work for? Do you search specifically for drums when you've got your sample, you've manipulated it, you've got a melody you like? What's the thinking behind... Right, these are the drums I now need for this. Just experimentation with...
Yeah, so the drums are a lot of the sounds around the melodies. It's basically, again, this is when I had this machine. So I've been using this to sample, like, you slam a door. You do anything. You just hold this up to it. So you kind of look foolish running around the neighborhood or your house or whatever, just making sounds and trying to record it with a big box. And then you kind of... I load it all in. So at this point, it's all kind of experimental. I found it all kind of surf through a bunch of drum sounds and just be like, okay.
Are you like the purist who like, I only sample off vinyl, or do you sample anywhere, just like YouTube?
Anywhere. Yeah. I don't think, from anywhere. But most of my drums come from just like homemade.
Yeah. Oh, you just bang on stuff?
Yeah, just bang on. Yeah, especially at this time, cool. It was all banged on stuff. Or free loops drums that are affected enough, and you can
Oh, you actually use some of the 3D
drums? Yeah. On this beat, there's stock drums that I blended with another set of drums. And again, it's all just kind of like listening to it and seeing, like, is it working? At this point, I didn't quite have good speakers either. So people that have that kind of situation, take it somewhere that does. Like, if you can get to a place that, say, like...
Sometimes having the simplest equipment just makes you push yourself to...
Yeah, you kind of just, you know, you work it out. I remember the first time I heard this really was at... was playing at Low in Theory, which is a venue in Los Angeles. And
I think most people who are watching a Teebs Masterclass will know what Low in Theory is.
True. So that was the first time I ever heard it louder than, like, you know, computer speakers that are about this big. So it was pretty interesting to, like, get hit by your own sound. Again, with the drums too, I always kind of, at this point, I was doing melodies first. So when I started adding drums, I always pitch them up and then slowly bring them down to, because I, you know, once you start manipulating sounds like this, I have a lot of different keys and things going on, and the timing starts getting really warped. You can find parts that, you know, you're basically going to run into a lot of trouble with the sound. So for me, if you pitch the drums up and kind of slowly dial them back, you'll find where the pocket that sits sonically well. So it's kind of like a, how do I put that, I guess? Yeah, you just want to find that pocket. Because another thing, too, is everything you want to sound good together, because that's the idea of good music.
I know a lot of producers, a friend of mine, Eric Lau, he plays all his, after he's taken sample, he'll do his bass line all in a really, really high pitch. Because it's really easy to get a dirty, low-sounding thing and be like, oh, that sounds good. But if it sounds really good in a very, very high pitch, then you take it down a few octaves, and it's obviously going to be, like, a lot more in tune and in sync with
it.
So after you've taken a sample, you've put in your drums, what comes next?
You just make a song out of it, because now you just have... at this point, you have, like, this eight-second loop of just an idea. And then you just start to build, like, okay, how do I make this melody not so stagnant? How do I...
Do you, like, for additional, like, to create a bass line that goes with it, is it, like, filtering the sample to a low frequency, or is it...
It always depends on the sound itself. You know, it's always fun to take anything you record and, you know, take out the filters. I always say experiment with everything. If you're using computers like that, or you have gear that gives you the options to do that, I suggest running it through the gauntlet of everything you can do to it. That's another thing that I always do, is just go through the process. Like, let's see if I can chop it. Let's see what that does to it. Let's see what that does to it. And you just keep kind of, you know, kneading it until something comes out of it.
And then in terms of sequencing, like building sounds in and out, is it quite... I'm assuming it's not, but is there a sort of formula or prescriptive way that you do it, or is it all just...
No, I think that's definitely comes to who you are as a person. I mean, there's formulas, and I remember at this point I was getting more into sounds, and I was looking at music I liked more objectively and thinking, like, okay, this is the process. It's like an A, like, you know, songs have their choruses, their bridges, and their, like, if it's a rap track, you got your verses. So you kind of can think it like that, like maybe break it down by... that process, like an A, B, C, A, B, A kind of thing. Like, you can make up your own idea and then just keep working that way.
I guess when you don't have the sort of constraints of working with a rapper and it's just a beat on for its own purpose, you can just run wild with whatever composition you want to put with it.
Yeah, you're free to, or I guess you're kind of challenged to fill that gap of, like, a human voice, I feel. And so, yeah, you kind of work that way.
So time's going quick. We're already at the halfway point.
I know. We're kind of
tick. So do you want to move on to... Should we move to another beat?
Or? Yeah, maybe we'll move to another beat.
So it's while you're doing that, I guess one thing which I just quickly checked the Wikipedia, I just assumed you were an LA guy, but you actually... you've moved around America quite a lot.
Yeah, randomly, but
the only reason I bring that up is because I'm wondering whether you're very much involved and sort of a key figure in the Los Angeles beat scene, and I wonder whether that sort of shapes the kind of music you make in terms of like the surroundings, the people who you you know, work with, collaborate with, or even just hang around with. You're telling me, hopefully, we'll not run out of time and we'll hear some new stuff, but you were recording in Fly Low Studio and obviously being on Brainfeeder, which is the home of people like Daedalus and Thundercat. Do you think that your environment plays quite a strong part in sort of the sonics that you put together?
Yeah, definitely. I think a lot of the beats that came off my first record, Our Door, was a almost like a direct response to a lot of the sound happening in Los Angeles around that time. So like the Ross G's and the Daedalus and not even just LA, I guess like Dabri and a lot of just producers that were kind of making very their sound focused music that wasn't really.
I always actually like thought Dabri and obviously Dilla, but I thought Dabri always got overlooked as like someone who was such a key figure in this whole like quote unquote beat scene, because 1-3 was for me
was
like
insane,
a total game changer.
Yeah, that changed my life.
And he doesn't get mentioned the same way as a lot of, you know, obviously Flying Lotus and Jay Dilla, but Dabri for me is.
Yeah,
like his new album's forthcoming as well, and I'm just so hyped about it.
It's strange how those kind of things happen. It definitely was. It's, you know, one of the biggest records ever in my life. So I think about
1-3.
Yeah, 1-3. Yeah. Definitely, that changed a lot.
Is there any sort of artists, producers, musicians who you cite as influences, and you like? I really like that. Not in a sort of a derivative way, but like they're inspiring to you as.
Like today,
whenever.
It's just anyone that's really producing their own sound. Like if it's today, speaking of, I'm looking at like the Gomo guys from South Africa. They're really brilliant right now, and
it's a really interesting sound as well. It sounds so South African.
Well, that's the thing. It's very it does, and it's just very unique to who they are. And I think I definitely resonate with that feeling when I can hear somebody in there. But
so what are we gonna get into now?
I wanted to show that other Fruity Loops kind of slicer thing that I was kind of messing with back in the day. But this is a song that I chopped up some.
Which song is this? We're going to moving to collections now.
This was around that time. It actually never really came out officially, but it was.
Oh, this didn't come out official. Okay, exclusive.
But it's a. A sample I got from Rebecca Raff, and she was a harp player in Los Angeles, and then went from Rebecca Raff. At this point, we were just kind of working together.
So this isn't sampled from a record. This is actually her in the studio with you playing. Do you often work with musicians? And
yeah, that's kind of where I've been kind of gravitating towards. So this is more of a around collections time. 2011, I started working with more people and just kind of like making my productions as I usually do and having them kind of come in and telling them where I want them to kind of go, but letting them run with it from there. And so this is just something I pulled from that melody. It was like a. It's like basically still treating it like a sample. I'm chopping it a bunch. Yeah, I'm adding a filter, a reverb. If you want to look at those, it's almost this looks like a chaos pad. Or you can kind of choose, you know, what you want to keep.
How do these musicians How do they feel about, they come in, they play this thing, and then you just totally chop it up and change it? Presumably that's part of
Yeah, we have a, we talk first.
You have an understanding.
Yeah.
It's not like, hey, you messed up my harp. Like,
well, the idea is usually there's tunes that I work directly for, and it's just like, it's pure. And then there's, which I can play really quickly as well. And then there's stuff that's kind of like afterburner material that we, you know, we've done, I listened to, and it's like, well, this stuff's never really going to come out. And so I just repurpose it and let them hear it, you know what I mean? So this was a tune. Yeah, this is another one.
So manipulated from the harp? Or?
No. So those are just me playing chords on a keyboard that I picked up. I can show you a picture of it. It's a really, really crappy keyboard. I came prepared. MT-800. Most brilliant Casio ever.
See, slightly underplayed it when it, you were just like, it's just a 404 and the...
Okay, fruit, a little bit. Well, the thing is, this is the main production tools. But there's definitely, if I can get my hands on anything from the cheapest keyboards, that probably cost $80 to, you know, anything
do
more
you have,
expensive.
Do you have much like keyboards, analog gear, anything?
Or is it
fairly basic setup?
No, yeah, basically...
Can we get a quick inventory?
Inventory checklist. I have this thing. I actually bought it. I used to borrow it. And I also really like using this thing. It's a terrible picture. The Korg MS-2000, which is like blurry as heck, but it's more for like techno and stuff, but it has some nice sounds.
Yeah. Did you just pick these up like secondhand or like?
Yeah, this guy in San Diego gave me this one, and then this one I actually used on Why Like This, which is an earlier tune that... that song. That's this keyboard. So yeah, it was.
And each keyboard, you kind of move towards it because there's a particular sound you want to get.
Yeah, you just kind of run through the stock sounds, and if it sounds good, you mess with it. You try to make it not sound like the stock sound, or I would enjoy it for what it is as well.
Yeah.
You just make some sounds. Record yourself for a few hours and make a lot of really, really terrible sounds, and then from there you find something you like.
So with this, I noticed that the drums are a lot more in the foreground, like they knock quite a bit more.
This one?
Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, that's just selective too. Like, again, when you're working with sounds, it's always about really listening, and as you work and you produce, you start to understand what it is. You let the loops play, and I usually like to walk away from what I'm working on and take my time. If you look at my release cycles, it takes a lot longer than most.
This is quite a good thing to lead on to. Do you try and, like, how quickly do you work? Is it quite a slow process? You revisit it a lot with the production and the beats? Is it something you go back to, like, oh, there's that beat 2 months ago, I want to go back to it? Or is it you try and wrap it all up in a certain time frame?
It's a mix, you know? It's usually, I would love to take my time. I usually like to make stuff, and I leave it, and then I forget about it, and then come back and listen to it with fresh ears. I think that's another important part, is actually not rushing things or trying to sound like anybody. You just want to listen to it really objectively and think, like, do people need to hear this, you know? Basically, if they already heard this before, or how does it make you feel, honestly, without feeling like you put a lot of time into it, you know?
Yeah.
Because some songs I can make in a day, some songs take me a whole year. So, you know.
A year?
Yeah, I'm really slow.
Just revisiting it in.
Yeah, and just tweaking it.
Are you one of those people who you're a bit of a perfectionist? So
not at all. You've heard those drums. I'm very, really, like, sparse and everywhere. It's more about just...
But even people with loose drums and, like, a quite...
Of course.
Float,
yeah,
they can
yeah,
still
no.
be like, I haven't finished it yet.
I'm not even trying to say looseness is, you know, not caring, but it's definitely every time you hear it, you should feel something, I feel. It should be something that you connect to it with and not just like, I put a lot of time into it.
Do you, because I know some producers who, it sounds like when you've got that feeling and it's done, do you have to play it to other people and sometimes get like heard opinion before you can be like, right, it's finished now? Because I know a lot of producers who can't let go of it.
Right.
And then it almost takes other people going, that's sick. What you need, that needs to be come out now before they sort of have the confidence to feel it's finished.
Yeah, understanding when it's finished is definitely hard. I think if it kind of, again, depends on the person. For my process, I wait till the whole record's done before I start showing it. And then I think you really get an idea of, like, you know, the mood of things. When you have more people involved, more energy in a room, you start understanding, like, oh, that's what it did. Or when I go out and play live and I let the music ring out and I just see people just, like, standing there, not, you know, just really, like, off-put by it. I'm just like, oh, okay.
So you test out material before you release it?
Yeah, not everything, but every once in a while I'll pull a few songs that I'm even iffy about putting it out or not, but... it's still in that realm where my head's at, I guess. And if people really don't react, or, you know, if they don't do what I was hoping them to do, whether it be like cringe or whatever emotion I'm looking for, then yeah, maybe I go back and tweak it. Because I think you kind of feel it as yourself as the energy bounces back to you when you're playing the music, and you just like, oh yeah, you don't like that. I don't really like that right now either. So I'm gonna change that.
And I'm running it. I think we're, you know,
yeah,
time is going way quicker than I thought. So maybe if you want to load something up that you want to show us next. But with the, where do you feel most comfortable in your environment? Is it at home or in the studio on your own? Or are you know, you talk about playing out material live in front of an audience. Are they just different experiences for you? Or, because I know a lot of people, producers, they're real comfort or safety zone is actually just making beats and performing out, and it's something that they do almost, you know, I don't want to say just as a source of income, but it's something that they do as part and parcel of being an artist. What's your relationship between actually the creation of it and the performance of it?
When I perform, I really like to, I mean, up till now, what I've been doing is trying to bring a very humbled bedroom approach to this whole idea of that this is some experimental music by one person that, you know, of course, if there's songs with, say, Rebecca Raff, there's other people involved, but it's just I like to bring that approach of, like, you're coming to my house, like, you're getting some food from my house that I cooked, and that's, like, I think that's my connection to playing live. I think, is that what you're kind of asking?
You're bringing, like, people into your...
Just kind of just saying that there's another perspective in general, not so much me, but just, you know, these sounds, I feel like.
Therefore, where you play is quite important because it needs to be a receptive crowd who's into.
Yeah, I guess if it's not like a Friday rave, it might not work so well, but
yeah,
that does matter.
So what are we going to go into?
I think since time's going so fast, I think I'd rather just move towards like some unreleased ideas and.
Some unreleased stuff, that's what...
I'm just kind of move into...
Yeah, let's get to it.
Where the production's been going. And,
so you're currently working on...
this keyboard.
You're currently working on a new album, I presume?
Yeah.
How's that going? Is it quite a liberating process, or is it actually quite stressful because you feel the sort of pressure of...
It's stressful to finish songs, to make them... relatable to more people than just yourself. I always feel like it's easy to make something and feel really good about yourself and listen to it and be like, oh, yeah, this is great, crazy, or whatever, and have your time with it. But to make something kind of, if you're making your own language, and if you want people to communicate with you, you got to kind of figure out, you know, how do you curve the letters just right so people can actually read it. And that's a little tricky, I feel.
So how's the new album going? Is it?
I mean, it's going. It feels pretty fun. It's a lot different. So basically, to kind of go back to that first song we played, that was very only no samples and really just early and sample-based stuff. My production has kind of been moving more into making sounds and having people that I work with closely.
It's a lot more about collaboration.
Yeah, so what I do is I break samples down, do what I do with them, and then work with people that I really feel can express those sounds. So I actually have friends come and replay certain sounds. And then from there, we just start kind of changing the whole environment of the song. And I think this one might be a better example of that. So this is a tune called Da Booth, because we made it in my friend's booth that he had that day. So we're going to just...
In the booth.
So that's our working title right now.
Right.
I think this might be a fun one.
And
to
so you say you collaborate. So who's worked on this track with you?
Okay, so this song is me, my friend Ringo, who goes by Mind Design, lives in Los Angeles at the moment, and a guy named Michael Lundy, who's a guitar player. And if I can follow, here we go. Find this.
When you guys collaborate, is it quite a relaxed atmosphere where you know you're just chilling?
Yeah, it's
not
silly.
Like, right, studio time. We've got you do this. You get on the guitar. I'm assuming it's quite relaxed.
It's very relaxed. I think that's just the way I like things. So I'm just gonna ring this out. This is some frogs I recorded while I was traveling. So we'll start with that. I'm just rearranging the samples now so I can, just get a loop set up that you can hear.
You're literally rearranging and composing right now.
So here is as a guitar sample that I played. It took me a very long time to learn how to play, because I'm very slow at this kind of stuff.
You actually played the guitar yourself?
Yeah. Okay. It took me a long time. And
you really underplayed it when you just said it was this in Fruit Loops.
Well, again, I'm telling you, this is what's really happening. And I sampled it, and I did my usual process of layering stacks and letting it kind of ring out like that.
Is it quite a basic, just holding a guitar up to a mic up to an acoustic guitar, or do you actually run it through some kind of amp? Or?
Yeah, basic mic and guitar.
Oh, it's a real lo-fi.
Yeah. So then I took this sound and I ran it through the pitch shift, which is on this machine. And I basically just made it sound like this.
Pitching it down.
Yeah, through the sampler. And made a recording with the drums that you're hearing earlier, and I can kind of bring back in. Which ones?
Are you pitching it down using this? Or you?
Yeah, this was in here. This is straight to the machine.
Oh, so it's literally quickly.
Yeah. Straightforward. And I really liked just the level that sounds at. I thought that was much more interesting than the original. So I took that sound and I gave it to a buddy. Let's see. Let me just play this. This is like an iPhone recording, just a quick one. But so you took that original guitar.
Oh, and this is your friend who's...
Yeah. Few of the roughs.
So you get the basic idea from your own playing, and then you get someone who's like a
can actually play guitar.
And,
yeah. Right. So then from there, I'll play a quick rough demo of it. My friend was on viola here, but she's not. There's a few demos of this song, but here's my friend on viola playing over the same tune. And this is just one at a time in that booth that we are like working in.
And again, this is just like a mic up to the viola, and it's all quite raw.
Yeah,
Who's playing this violin? The viola, sorry.
Oh, no worries. It's actually Sophie from
Sophie,
Boiler Room.
Yeah. I wanted to say, but I didn't want to.
Yeah.
She's dope on piano and violin. Yeah,
man. Definitely a fan. And then a quick rough edit of the demo we have. I'll play that now. And this is like a piano's edit from Mind Design. Sophie's not on this rough edit right here, but we'll just let that play.
It's a lot of the stuff we can expect to hear. It's a lot more collaboration based than with the.
Yeah.
Do you prefer it in terms of like a creative process working with other people?
Yeah, I think it's great. I mean, it's to see what we just heard now from the what I had is. I think that's
it's definitely
just
an evolution.
Yeah, it's just it's amazing to me, and I think that's why I prefer it so much. And just seeing how it can transform so much and become something that so many hands, you know, put forward. It's just nicer to me.
Are you quite controlling as a producer? As in, like, you work with this guitarist, you work with someone who's doing on the viola or whatever, and be like, I want you to do this. I want it to sound like this, and almost like. You know, like you see people like Kanye in the production, he's got like orchestras and he's like humming it out, like very specific. Or is it more like, you know, an interaction where you're like, you just do your thing, I'm going to work with that, and then it's more of a conversation?
It's a little bit of a conversation that leads into me kind of being more demanding. It's kind of like I want to see what they can do in general before I put my input, because I have ideas already. And then I let them kind of ride out for a good hour. And then we kind of discuss, and I go into the parts that I like, and then I tell them what I actually wanted, and then we kind of find a harmony between the new sounds.
So we're almost at the end. So just if there is anyone in the crowd who maybe wants to, has anyone got a mic? Has anyone got any questions that they wanted to ask Teebs? Is anyone? There we go.
Where do you mix your tracks?
At home. And what I used to do to try to understand mixing better without any assistance or money was we have this place called it's like a music store. Basically a music audio store, you can buy anything. So what I would do is take
like a hi-fi store. Like.
Yeah, like where you can buy all your gear from or whatever. And they usually have rooms that sell monitors, like studio monitors. So what I used to do, it was take...
Go and check out their equipment for free. And just
well, basically take a CD of something that I knew sounded good, and then take my CD and listen to both, one after the other, and just try to understand, like, this is what good music sounds like on this kind of speaker that's similar to what I have. So, okay, memorize where those sonics are hitting you through those monitors. Go home and tweak your shit. So that's kind of how I worked that out at first. And then I still mix at home. This one, these are really nasty at different people's places, but ideally I mix at home and then I take it to a studio to get it mastered eventually. There's Daddy Kev at Apple Pub Studios, Cosmic Zoo.
Thanks.
Daddy Kev pretty much works with the whole scene in LA, right?
Yeah,
his ear is amazing.
He's everywhere.
It's interesting you said that about playing something next to you, like Stephen Christian, who's at A&R at Warp Records, who obviously gets sent tons of demos. And after a while, when you hear demo after demo, you kind of be like, is this good anymore? Is it just good because it sounds, it's the best of the batch? and he would like cleanse his palate by stopping, taking a break, listening to his favorite record, and then listening to the demo next to it, and just to like for perspective. But it is interesting that you basically put your music and then put it next to something that you really like. Is there any more questions from the crowd? We are running out of time, but we could maybe squeeze one more if there's someone in. I think we've covered quite a lot of ground. Great, thanks very much. Thanks to BUDx. Thanks to everyone in the room and watching online. Thank you very much.
Yeah, man.
That was really...
Felt fast.
Huh?
It felt fast.
Yeah, that went quick. There was actually a bunch more tracks we wanted to go through, but
yeah,
we've run out of time. So thanks very much.
Yeah, man, of course. Thank you.